we're going to worship the Lord with a couple of songs. Love the Lord, and I sing the mighty power of God. And as God has blessed us in so many ways, let's offer our blessings now to God. Kids. Remember last week we talked about these. Oh, there's Hunter. Come forward, Hunter. Welcome. It's going to be, and Hunter brought a friend. This is going to be so fun. I'm so glad I brought a towel. Two towels. Three towels. Last week we talked about these objects. And do you know what they're called? Anybody?
Yes.
Piggy banks. And I was very proud of myself that we talked about piggy banks, and little tiny ones, and they come in all sizes. And then somebody said, well, why are they called piggy banks? At which point I was embarrassed to say, I don't know. So, I researched the story behind piggy banks. And Do you know that piggy banks have nothing to do with pigs? Piggy banks have nothing to do with pigs. Instead, they have to do with, this is fresh, this stuff. Do you know what that is? Clay. Who says clay? Who says this is clay? Anybody say this is clay? I have a hand back there. Anybody, yes? Amen to clay? Clay? Somebody say not clay.
Not clay.
Oh, you know the secret, don't you? Very good. There's one person who... This isn't clay. No. If you were in, around the 4th or 5th or 6th century England, if you were in Old English, this material was known as pigge. Pigge. Say that with me. Pigge.
Pigge.
This is pigge. And as money began to be developed, then people wanted to store stuff away. So they would make little containers out of pigge, which sounds like piggy. And so as the containers were made, I have absolutely no piggy skills. So as the containers were made into something useful, somebody's going to turn this into something pretty, I hope. There's a piggy bank. Right? That's a piggy bank made by me. Okay, that's a piggy bank. But what happens over time as people get lazy with the language? Pigge becomes piggy. So they say, oh, it sounds like piggy. And the original meaning of the word for clay got forgotten. And then by magic processes, look what I made. Okay, no. But that's where the piggy bank came from. It came from pigge, pigge, the original word for clay, which over time got messed up and became piggy banks. Cool, eh? So isn't that funny how we forget what a word really means? I mean, how many of you knew that the actual word for clay was pigge? It's like me. We were totally ignorant of the history of this, but that's where it came from. So sometimes things can have different names and different values, but the important thing to remember is it's not what we have in the piggy bank, but what we do with it, right? So that's our story for today. A funny name and a cool product, and now as a result of this, Brian has 10 pounds of clay to play with. And, see, since I was clever, I brought a wet towel. And I'm smart enough not to let the kids have it until Brian has it. Okay, let's bow our heads and pray with me. God, we thank you.
For pigget.
And useful things like clay.
And
piggy banks
and
money
and
names for things. Help us to learn
more about your world,
the funny names,
the use of money,
and the interesting stories
that come with things
and people.
Amen.
And we're going to pray again, and you don't have to join me this time if you don't want. Let's bow our heads. Loving God, we do indeed give you thanks for being here. Any opportunity we have to worship you is a good thing. And we pray that as we worship,
As we listen to your stories, as we hear your word, that your spirit will fill us, that it will open our eyes and our hearts and minds to truly sense your presence here in this time. And it will also remind us that it's not just when we gather here in worship, but wherever we are that you are present. And we know that sometimes it's the things that worry us, the mistakes that we've made, the pain caused by others that gets in the way of our noticing you, of paying attention to your presence in the world. So we ask that you forgive us for these distractions, for these sins, for these pains, and we pray that your Holy Spirit will cleanse us, that your Son's action on the cross will forgive us, and that he will be the example by which we lead our lives. We offer these words in his name, and we say together, Amen. And now I'm going to invite Phyllis to share the word.
Today's word, stocks or bonds, God's portfolio, usually relationships with God and others, stewardship. And our reading comes from Matthew 22, verses 34 to 40. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself."
Thank you.
And our second reading today is from Matthew 6, verses 19 to 27. Do not store up yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, and your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life?
Finger read. So today we're going to talk a little bit about stocks and bonds. And since I know I'm going to get called on it by certain people who want to know the origin of words like piggy bank, I'm going to talk about why we have stocks and bonds. Do you know why we have a bond? What is a bond? Bond is an agreement. It's an agreement between two people that they will give them something in return for something else. So a bond became an agreement between a ruler or somebody with money that if you give me money, I will use the money for whatever I need it for, but I will give you a guaranteed profit on that money. I will give you interest. My bond, my promise, is that the money you give me will generate more cash for you. So that's a guarantee. It's an absolute. Now, stocks are slightly different. Stocks are a way of investing in companies or in people or in products. And stocks can be traded as can be bonds. You can take that promise that you're going to invest in a company and you can trade it around to people. And the reason it's called a stock is because the place where in England where the first true stock market was established was on the side on the property of an old stockyard. Ain't that exciting? So you would trade these documents on the property of where these old stockyards were, so the name just arose from that. But stocks have an older history than that. Believe it or not, they actually started this idea of trading these documents, of my being able to say, well, I've got a piece of paper that says I invested in you, and I'd rather invest in him, but I don't want to bother him, so you have an investment in him, and so why don't I give you my paper, and you can have the investment in whatever I have in, and we can trade them about. And this started in Belgium, in Antwerp, about the 14th or 15th century. So this idea that we could trade these promises, these notes, these investments, it's about 400 or 500 years old. But the first true
And in order to understand why these investments matter, let me tell you about the first true stock as we consider it today. The first true stock came about as a result of the British Empire's expansion to the Far East. Now, as you can imagine, sailing from Britain to India would be a dangerous journey. You'd have to go all the way around Africa in order to get to India, or else you'd have to go overland. Now, as you can imagine, if you tell an investor, I've got a ship and I'd like to sail to India, and once I'm in India, I'm gonna get all these products really cheaply and come back, and then you can share the profit in me. But I need to help pay for the ship, and I need to pay for crew, and I need to pay for the supplies that are gonna get me there with my crew. And the investor says, okay, sure, I'll invest. And then the ship sinks. And what happens to the investor's money? Sinks too. So the investor is out everything. The ship owner is out everything. So what folks decided to do, what the British government decided to do to encourage investment, because this was a good thing, they knew it. I mean, the products were coming back and they were cheap and they were exotic and they were necessary. So what the British government did was it issued a charter to the East India Company that allowed you and me, your people with money, to buy a small share of that company, to buy an investment in that company, so that now, when a ship went over, we were investing in that ship, yes, but we weren't paying for the entire ship out of our pocket. We as an entire congregation, let's say, were investing in that ship. So if that ship sank, well, yes, we did lose our money, but we didn't lose everything, right? We didn't lose our entire life savings. But what was also permitted in the charter, or what was also accepted in the charter, was, well, okay, if we're going to invest in this company, you're not just going to invest in a ship. Your investment would be maybe spread over two or three or four ships, which meant that the odds were one of those ships would come back and make a good profit. So now our risk is being spread out over all of us, and it's going to be spread out over a number of ships or caravans going to India. That means that our profit, it's not guaranteed. I mean, it's possible that all four ships go down, but it's more than likely that at least one, if not two, will come back and we will make a profit on our investment. And at the same time, while we're making a profit on our investment, then others also, all of us, are making a profit, and we're able to take advantage of the new products, the spices, the foods, the cloths, all of the things that were starting to come out of India and China and Japan as they opened up. So this idea of the stock market was basically allowing us to share a broad investment into a risky venture so that everybody won. Worked out for everybody. Worked out extremely well for the owners of the East India Company, but it also worked out well for England, and their economy rose tremendously as they started getting these cheap and exotic goods that everybody wanted. And at the same time, the risk was spread out so that folks could actually afford to invest without risking everything. So over years, that charter started going going out to other companies so that other companies could do the same thing, right? You wanted to invest in an auto manufacturer, but the auto manufacturer would now have a bunch of shareholders where the risk would be spread out over all of us and the profit would come to all of us as well. And that's a nutshell story of stocks and bonds and shares. It's a way of spreading our investment out in ways that are less risky and more advantageous. Now, of course, there are some problems with the stock market and these kind of investments, and they concern things like ethical stocks. As Presbyterians, our church does invest in the stock market, especially for our pension plan, but we're very careful not to be involved in money laundering or arms sales or investments in governments or places where there's torture or human rights abuse. So that's one of the risks of stocks. The other risk of this kind of thing is the same risk that always comes up with money, and Jesus talks about that in our reading today, where he talks about not being able to serve two gods, right? If you put your treasures on things of the earth, things like stocks and bonds, then your heart tends to get caught up in stocks and bonds and forgets the treasures that are in heaven. Now, Jesus was asked a challenging question. He was asked what the most important command was, and he says to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and your neighbor as yourself. So I want to think about that as our stock, our share in God. God has invested heavily on us. Pete, I'm going to get my sheet so I can follow along too. God has invested in terms of earth and everything that sustains life for us. God has given us an eternal commitment to our well-being. That promise that comes in Jesus, you can go ahead, Pete. That promise that comes from Jesus, where we are going to have treasures in heaven, where we have a heavenly life, where this life is a good life, but it isn't all there is, that God will love us now and for eternity. That's God's eternal promise. God gives us freedom to make mistakes. That's an investment that God has made, where we are actually allowed to mess up. And it is an investment. I call it an investment because God is allowing us to do something that's kind of illogical in some ways, right? To allow us to make mistakes would mean that we could go against God, that we could disobey God. But that's also the only way we can learn and we can grow, and that God can make us truly free. If God didn't invest in us this way, if God didn't give us this, I'd say, privilege in some ways, then we'd simply be little playthings. We'd be like this little pig here, right? We'd just be an object that God could move about that has no free will. God also invested in us through the rules and regulations that help us to understand and to keep away from those mistakes, right? If God has given us the freedom to make mistakes, he's also taught us how to act responsibly through his commandments. God has given us leaders to show the way. God has given us mercy and forgiveness. And God has given us grace. The grace is the undeserved love that we have. Just as we are invited to love God with all our heart, mind, and soul, God loves us undeservedly through his grace. And he reveals that love through his mercy and forgiveness, through that desire to keep us on his side even if we blow it. So these are God's investments in us. These are sort of the original charter papers. So if God has invested in us, then that demands an investment from us in return. God invites us to invest in Him in these ways. Where's our page here? Yes, there we go. God has invested in us, the earth, and everything that sustains life. Our response, our investment, is to be good stewards of creation, to use it wisely, not for our own advantage, but as a gift to be enjoyed and to be shared and to be sustained and to be kept so that our children and our children's children, the generations to come, will benefit and be blessed by it and enjoy its beauty. As God has given us His eternal promise, we invest in God by giving Him our eternal love, a love that isn't just in this life, but in the life that's to come. As God has given us the freedom to make mistakes, we commit to God to do our best, to learn from our mistakes, to try not to make them, but to figure out, okay, we blew it this way, maybe we should not do that again. Go on the next page. God has given us the rules and regulations to guide us. Well, it's up to us to follow them faithfully. And if we can't follow them faithfully, then we go back to the previous investment where God has given us the permission to make mistakes, and we try hard again. We also have leaders that show us the way, and we follow those leaders, right? That's our response, is that we support them, we follow them, we hold our leaders accountable, right? Because they're free to make mistakes as well. So we hold our leaders accountable so that they aren't just going by their own will, but we try together to go by God's will. Next one. We have our justice, mercy, forgiveness that God gives us, and that's what God requires back from us. Our investment is to practice justice, to be merciful, to forgive. And finally, God's grace. God's grace means to love without restraint. Just as we are loved despite our mistakes, despite our imperfections, God loves us no matter what. We are invited, we are investing in God by loving without restraint. Now this is the part where we get to the infomercial. Because I say, but wait, there's more. Because this is, as I said, this is the opening investment plan that God has in us. But through Christ, God invested even more deeply within us. So next slide, please. God's greater investment comes in Jesus' own life. Sorry, I gotta keep this here. Jesus came to show us how to live, the very presence, the Word on earth. Jesus was then sent to the cross in order to forgive us. And with Jesus' resurrection, love overcame sin and promised us eternal life. So that's God's greater investment in us through Christ. And that involves a greater investment in us in response. So if Jesus, go to the next slide. If Jesus came to show us how to live, then our investment is to live like Jesus. If Jesus came to forgive us through the cross, then our investment is to forgive like Jesus. If Jesus came to take us from that cross, to give us an eternal life where love beats sin, then our investment is to love like Jesus. This is our portfolio. This is how we invest in God, what carries us through to life. God has shown us how to live through Christ. God has forgiven us when we don't live like Christ. God has loved us and will love us for eternity. That's God's promise for us. So there are three things that we need in our portfolio, and that's it. That is to live like Christ, to forgive like Christ, to love like Christ. So I ask you one question. What is in your portfolio? How have you invested in God? Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, we do indeed you call you loving because we recognize that through all that you have done for us, you have revealed a love that is beyond understanding. We see it, but we don't know it. We see it in the way that you have ordained creation to work together for the good, to be a blessing that takes care of itself. We don't have to do anything. The birds, the flowers take care of themselves and provide for us abundantly if we take care of them properly. You have given us the freedom to make mistakes. You have given us rules and leaders that show us the way. You have given us your grace, your justice, your mercy, all of those good things that help us to be righteous. And we pray, God, that you help us to respond accordingly, that you do help us to be stewards of creation, maintaining it, preserving it, keeping it beautiful, thinking of it not in simply terms of one generation, but an eternity of beauty. We don't know how long we are on this earth, but we know that you have a lifelong promise that extends before beyond our lives. And so we ask that you help us to ensure that our actions will maintain and preserve the earth for as long as you need it to be here. We ask, God, that in the places where there is injustice, you help us to bring justice about. Where refugees seek to escape violence, corrupt governments, or even family members, husbands, spouses that are violent, where they seek to get away from those situations to find a safe place to start again, or perhaps simply to pause until it's safe to go on. We pray that you give us open and willing hearts to take care of them. When we look to the poorest of our own nation, when we look to those who have been rejected and despised, when we especially look to the Aboriginal population and see how their rights have been trampled upon, how they are not supported, how the suicide rate among the young people is horrendous, we ask that you help us to find justice for them, that you help us to be a source of healing and strength. And we pray that as a population of Canadians, but more importantly, as your faithful children, brothers and sisters to Christ, you help us always to live justly, to love so that others may know and see Jesus, and to act in ways that not only reveal Jesus, but serve a practical good that help people to live better lives. And God, finally, we just ask that if we're the ones that are in need, if we're doubtful or afraid, if we're hungry or in need, then we pray that you help us to be willing receivers, that you open our hearts to the gifts that others have to offer us, that you release us from our guilt or embarrassment or shame that we need to ask for help, that we empower others to use their gifts. We offer these words in Jesus' name. Amen. And please rise for a benediction. Now may the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Christ himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen.